Let's go back to our dietary lipids that have now been broken down and absorbed. Inside the enterocyte, fatty acids are reassembled into triglycerides, phospholipids, and cholesterol esters. Short and some medium-chain fatty acids, since they are very small and more polar, can go directly into the bloodstream where they bind to albumin. They take the portal vein and go to the liver. Everything else instead, which is the vast majority of dietary lipids, has always the same problem. Lipids are insoluble in water, so they cannot be sent by themselves into the watery bloodstream. So before they leave the enterocyte, these lipids are packaged in a particular structure which is called a lipoprotein. A lipoprotein is composed of a core which contains all the hydrophobic lipids, and in particular triglycerides and cholesterols, and a coat surrounding them which is composed of a layer of phospholipids with all their polar heads facing outside, and some proteins which are called apoproteins and are needed for lipoprotein to be trafficked and recognized by several receptors on the surface of our cells. This external water-soluble shell of phospholipids and proteins allows the lipoprotein to float freely in the watery environment of the bloodstream or the lymph. The major lipoprotein built in the intestine cells is called chylomicron. The composition of chylomicrons largely reflects the lipid composition of the food we eat, so in general they are very rich in triglycerides, around 80 to 90%. For this reason, they tend to be very large and have a very low density. Remember that lipids are less dense than water. Because they are very large, when they exit the enterocyte, chylomicrons do not go directly into the bloodstream and take the lymphatic circulation instead. They will then enter the circulation in the large subclavian vein via the thoracic duct. The final destination of chylomicrons is the liver. However, since they don't take the portal vein, they have a long way to go before they arrive. During this time, the chylomicron will release most of its triglycerides to the cells of our body that need them, mainly muscle cells for energy and adipose cells for storage. On the walls of the exchange capillaries with muscle and adipose tissue is located a particular enzyme, lipoprotein lipase, which sucks triglycerides out of the lipoproteins and brings them inside the cells. When they arrive to the liver, chylomicrons are still very rich in cholesterol. The liver will disassemble them, take their cholesterol, and decide what to do with it, depending on what is needed. The liver may use cholesterol for its own needs or to build bile salts, decide to get rid of it through the bile, or send it back to the bloodstream to be used by other cells in our body. To send lipids into the circulation, the liver builds its own kind of lipoprotein, which is called VLDL, or very low density lipoprotein. Compared to chylomicrons, VLDLs contain less triglycerides and more cholesterol, so they're a little bit smaller and more dense. They do not only carry exogenous cholesterol coming from the intestine via chylomicrons, but also endogenous liver-made cholesterol, since, as you know, the liver is able to make its own cholesterol. The main lipids carried by VLDLs, however, are still triglycerides. Once in the bloodstream, VLDLs will give their triglycerides to the cells via lipoprotein lipase and become denser and relatively richer in cholesterol. They become what is called a VLDL remnant, or IDL for intermediate density lipoprotein. The LDL remnants can go back to the liver and be cleared from the blood, but typically, while they're still in the bloodstream, they are converted by remodeling of their apoproteins into yet another kind of lipoprotein, which is called LDL for low density lipoprotein. LDL is the major cholesterol-transporting lipoprotein in our bloodstream, and it's responsible for finally delivering it to the cells that need it for growth or synthesis of hormones. Its core is mostly made of cholesterol, which is why they're denser and smaller than VLDLs. The way LDLs deliver cholesterol to cells is different from the way chylomicrons and VLDLs deliver triglycerides. Chylomicrons and VLDLs give away some of their triglycerides via the action of lipoprotein lipase, but they stay in the bloodstream and keep circulating. Instead, the LDL particle is completely uptaken and disassembled inside the cell, which binds it via a specific protein on its surface called LDL receptor. The big problem with LDLs is that if cells do not need their cholesterol or if we have more LDLs in the circulation than cholesterol is needed, then they will not be cleared from the bloodstream and will keep circulating. A prolonged residence time of LDLs in the bloodstream makes them susceptible to structural modifications such as oxidation and changes in their apoprotein structures. These alterations abolish their ability to bind to the LDL receptors and instead increase the affinity for another non-specific type of receptor called scavenger receptor that is present on macrophages and recognizes chemically modified forms of LDL. Macrophages engulfing lots of LDLs eventually die and become foam cells, a hallmark of atherosclerosis. Oxidized LDLs are the primary cause of initiating atherosclerotic lesions in the walls of our arteries and are strongly associated with cardiovascular disease. A good dietary intake of antioxidant is helpful to maintain a good antioxidant state in our bloodstream and prevent LDL oxidation. Small, dense LDLs have a much stronger atherogenic potential because they have low affinity for the LDL receptors due to conformational changes in their apoproteins. Consequently, they tend to stay longer in circulation, they are more susceptible to oxidation, macrophage uptake through scavenger receptors, and foam cell formation. On top of that, smaller LDLs bind more easily to the arterial wall and can directly penetrate transendothelially. For these reasons, small dense LDLs are an independent predictor of cardiovascular disease. It is still not clear how small dense LDL originate. Genetic factors clearly are important, but high blood triglycerides also play a role. If LDLs start off containing more triglycerides, once they give them away via lipoprotein lipase, are left with less cholesterol and thus they are smaller and denser. When we measure total LDL cholesterol with our blood tests, we don't know if this cholesterol is carried in a few large LDLs, which is a better situation, or if it's split in many small dense LDL particles, which increases cardiovascular risk. To have that information, we must determine the number of LDL particles, or at least estimate it measuring apoprotein B. Since each lipoprotein particle carries only one apoprotein on the B type, the ratio of ApoB to LDL cholesterol allows us to estimate their size. All cells can express LDL receptors according to their cholesterol needs. If cholesterol is in excess of a cell's need, then the cell will reduce the number of LDL receptors on its surface to protect itself from overaccumulating cholesterol. This efficient homeostatic system protects the cell but comes at a high price. Excess cholesterol in LDLs will dangerously stay in our bloodstream, oxidize, and deposit in the walls of our arteries. Conversely, if cells need cholesterol, they can do two things. First, they can increase the number of LDL receptors on their surface so they can get more cholesterol from the bloodstream. At the same time, however, they can also induce the cholesterol enzyme to start building cholesterol themselves. From a cardiovascular health point of view, we prefer the first option because it allows more LDL cholesterol to be cleared from the bloodstream. However, as we already know, a diet rich in saturated fats, trans fats, and high glycemic index foods, such as simple sugar and refined grains, induces the activity of the cholesterol enzyme. And thus, not only does it promote endogenous cholesterol synthesis, but it also hinders its clearance from the bloodstream, where it can do more harm. Indeed, if cells are already making cholesterol themselves, they do not need to get it from the bloodstream. The last important class of lipoproteins we have to introduce is the HDLs, or high-density lipoproteins. These are relatively smaller and proportionally richer in proteins, therefore they are denser than all the other lipoproteins we have encountered. The main goal of HDLs is reverse cholesterol transport. They take back excess cholesterol from other circulating lipoproteins and from peripheral tissues, including dead cells, and very importantly, including macrophages and foam cells in the arterial wall. So they take it back from them, and then directly or indirectly, they deliver this excess cholesterol back to the liver for elimination through the bile. HDLs are mostly synthesized in the liver, but then they mature in the circulation by picking up stuff from other lipoproteins and cells. Cellular cholesterol efflux and reverse cholesterol transport is the classical function of HDLs. However, they have many other important anti-atherogenic functions, and in particular, anti-inflammatory activity, vasodilator activity, antithrombotic activity, and antioxidant activity thanks to the presence of antioxidant enzymes such as pyroxenase and glutathione peroxidase. This is especially useful to protect circulating LDLs from oxidation. For all these reasons, cholesterol carried in HDLs is usually labeled as good cholesterol, and a higher ratio between HDL and other lipoproteins is associated with protection from cardiovascular disease. However, not all HDL cholesterol is equally good. HDLs can become dysfunctional, pro-inflammatory and atherogenic, especially in diabetes and other clinical conditions associated with oxidative stress and inflammation. So while a high HDL is generally recognized as good, this is not always the case. This is also why some important studies using HDL-raising drugs proved to be very disappointing, increasing rather than lowering cardiovascular risk. The large dysfunctional HDL particles generated by these drugs were not efficient in promoting cholesterol efflux and reverse cholesterol transport. So to review the functions of lipoproteins, chylomicrons and VLDLs mainly transport and deliver triglycerides, while LDLs and HDLs mainly transport and deliver cholesterol. Chylomicrons carry dietary lipids from the intestine to the liver and give away some triglycerides to cells during their itinerary. VLDLs carry both dietary and liver-made lipids from the liver to other cells in the body. LDLs deliver both dietary and liver-made cholesterol from the liver to other cells in the body, but under certain conditions they may also end up depositing into the walls of our arteries, which is highly detrimental. Conversely, HDLs scavenge excess cholesterol from the cells in our body, other circulating lipoproteins, and the walls of our arteries, and bring it back to the liver for disposal.